Hello, and welcome to another episode of Zap Chat. And this time, we're going to be talking about modern web applications. And once again, I'm not on my own. I'm joined by Yanis. Hi, Yanis.
Hello.
So, the last time we did a demo was on Zap It. It seemed to work really well between the two of us with Yanis here. So that's why I've asked Yanis to come back. So it's a double act now. Anyway, what we're going to talk about is modern web applications and how ZAP can handle them better. We already handle modern web applications, but we know we could always do better. And we also know that we've had a survey done recently. Some of you may have filled that in. And handling modern web applications better has come up as the most important thing for you. So this is something we're already working on, but I wanted to show how far we've got. And you can see there's still quite a bit to do. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to share my screen. And hopefully you will be able to see ZAP. So this is ZAP 2.14. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go straight into the demo. And I want to show you a modern web application. And the web application I've chosen is Juice Shop, OWASP Juice Shop, which is a great modern web app. And what we need to do is we need to launch a browser and proxy through ZAP. Now, the easiest way is via this manual explore tab, because what this will do is this will launch the browser of our choice. I'm going to choose Firefox, not too surprisingly, given my history, but we support Chrome as well. And it sets ZAP sets the browser up, so it's proxying through ZAP and ignores certificate warnings. So we can just kick that off, and what we'll see is Firefox startup, and then we'll see Juice Shop. So this, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to navigate around a bit, look at various things, and actually I'm going to log in. Now I've already registered, so test@test.com and test123. Hopefully that'll work. Yep, so I'm now logged in. You can see my basket. There's nothing there. Now, Yanis, as I'm wandering around this application, what can you tell me about what it's doing?
Yeah, well, first of all, you can't really see much, right? It's a modern web app. So straight away, somebody who's either doing a penetration test or has inherited this app from a development perspective or gets to, you know, look after it, doesn't know that's the OWASP Juice Shop, is browsing around, should be able to notice that they don't have the immediate request response history that you would expect, given how much functionality is being browsed around by you, Simon. So that's point number one. There's something else here, right? So the question then is, what's that something else, and how do we tackle that from a coverage perspective, right?
Exactly. So have you noticed anything else about the application?
Yes, so you have, so diving into the detail a little bit, so it's using fragments, right? We can see that there's the URL hashtag complain. That's an indication of a modern web app. Fragments typically involve parts of events functionality that stay within the browser. They're part of the JavaScript functionality. And that's a key indication that something is happening that you're not seeing in your traditional proxy request in terms of request response. The fragments staying in the browser, just a small digression there, historically have the penetration testing finding that you should not trust what's in the browser. Well, you know, that's all well and true, or that was all well and true in 2005, where we could say that, but it doesn't really abide by the modern standards of, let's say, Node.js, plus all the other libraries that we have. JavaScript is here to stay, and we have the fragment functionality. And the question now is, let's make sure that we don't have vulnerable components. And what exactly is the trust that we're putting on the client-side browser that this JavaScript is proxying through through fragments?
Great, exactly. So as you said, it's difficult to see what's going on. And that's true of all web applications. So what we can do is, you know, this is one reason we have tools like ZAP. So we can see here from ZAP, we have this sites tree, and we have, well, we can see the web sockets, and we can see the history as well. So these are all of the requests that have been made And you can see the request and response. So we're getting lots of data, and we can see ZAP's understanding of the structure of the web application. Mm-hmm. Now, one thing you'll notice here is we don't see all of these fragments. We don't see the pages. We're just seeing the requests and responses in the background. And I think you alluded to this earlier, Yanis, but why are we not seeing the fragments in the sites tree?
Well, the fragments are a part of the component that stay within the browser. So therefore, there's not a particular post request that's leaving the browser when you click on an event through JavaScript, right? That is triggering a server-side response back. How that fragment works involves the client and the browser. Of course, there are callbacks as required, and it depends on the framework that's being used in the library. But more importantly, there's straight away a recognition, right, within the first, 10 minutes of using ZAP here. And imagine other tools don't do this so quickly, that we are not seeing the full spectrum of what is there to be investigated, right? So that's the reason behind it. And straight away, we know that there's something more there.
Exactly. And it's actually part of the spec that fragments should not get sent to the server. So ZAP doesn't see them, which means, and we know with modern web applications, a lot more is happening in the client or the browser, as we call it. So that is why we've got something new. We have what we call a client map, which is here on the sites tree. And to start with, it actually looks very much like the sites map, except if I expand it, you'll suddenly see these fragments. So we've got fragments, and we actually have a new client details tab here. And if I actually go down here, we have client history as well. So we suddenly have three new tabs, and they're giving us a lot more information. So what is happening here is we are getting information from the browser, directly from the browser. And I'll explain how that works later. And what happens is we're seeing the fragments, and we're building up a map of this application, the client side map. So we can see the different, essentially pages, what would have been traditional pages. And you can see we've got information about buttons, input fields, links, lots of interesting information. So we can see all this information, and the history shows all of it streaming through, and actually shows some extra information. So we can see nodes being added. So these are nodes dynamically added to the web pages. We can see a button is being added and the text is add to basket. And we can see DOM mutations. Now, so these are changes to the DOM. Now, we're not actually seeing the individual mutations because if you actually streamed all the browser events to a tool like ZAP, your computer would hang because there's so many. So we get a summary of the number of mutations every so often, but we see things like nodes added, so we can see input events or input fields, buttons, links, all these fun kind of things. We can see pages being loaded and unloaded. And particularly interesting, if you have a look here on the client map, we actually see things like cookies. I mean, ZAP sees the cookies as well, but we see local storage and session storage. If it's scroll, yeah, there we are. So we can see local storage and session storage. So this is information that traditionally has stayed in the browser, and your security tool would not have access to this at all. So this is brand new information. And what you'll see is we can actually, if you right click on these things, we get a set of options. The moment's only the client map has the right click option. We can copy the URLs to the clipboard, so we can select a whole load of them. We can open the browser, so I can actually just go and write, I want to open that particular URL in the browser, and you'll see we actually go straight to the basket there. So we are we're actually using the whole URL, which is also shown at the top here. And what else we've got? We can show it in the sites tree. Now that will show us the nearest part. Obviously, we don't have the fragment in the sites tree, so you don't get that.
This is really interesting, right? Because it's not that the fragment doesn't exist on the server side, but as you correctly said, according to the spec, and the same applies for local storage, you can look up the HTML5 spec there, the hashtag basket location exists as part of the client map, and the closest request as part of the sites map is then being offered back by ZAP. Yep. So why is that important if you are somebody, you know, who's attacking this application? It's important because then you know that any event or similar functionality that is leaving that specific fragment requesting to communicate with the server is likely going to come from this location on the sitemap, right? So you know where to focus your attack vector, if you like.
Exactly, thank you. So this is the information we've got at the moment. And so I'll explain how you get this, because this is not built into ZAP 2.14 yet. Well, it's not built into ZAP 2.14 at all. It is a new add-on. It is called client-side integration. Exposes client browser-side information in ZAP using Firefox and Chrome extensions. So that's how it's working, and I'll show that a bit more. So you will need to install it from the ZAP marketplace. Obviously, I've got it installed here. And at the moment, it is very early stage, so it's alpha status. It is exposing information which can be very useful for a pen tester. But there is an extra thing that it has got, which will provide value to some of you. So with modern web applications, if you're automating testing against them, you will probably be using the ZAP Ajax Spider. So the Ajax Spider launches browsers and controlled by Selenium and clicks on things, fills in forms. So that's how we can cope with modern web apps with a browser, because that's the only way you can really do it. Now, we know that the Ajax Spider is pretty good, but there are some client components that it struggles with. So particularly if you've got an element in a page which is not reachable, Selenium will try and get to it and get an error. And there's certain ones where it's just too difficult, or maybe it's not even exposed by the UI, but is in the DOM. And the client, the Ajax Spider, doesn't look at the DOM. The client add-on does look in the DOM. So one thing you'll see here is we've actually got some nodes here which don't have information. If you can see, they've got a small red minus, and that means we haven't visited them yet. And that what's happened is we found the client add-on has found these in the DOM and then has told ZAP about them. We know they haven't been visited. And if you run the Ajax Spider with the client integration add-on installed, then the client add-on will see that the Ajax Spider started. It'll then wait to the end and then report any URLs that it hasn't found. It will actually request them as well. So we're actually going to make the client, the Ajax Spider results slightly better. What I can show you, if I just drag another browser in. So if you go to zaproxy.org and go to documentation, then towards the end, you'll see test scans. So we run ZAP against a set of deliberately vulnerable applications, either nightly or weekly. And one of them is Google Security Crawl Maze. So this is designed by Google to be difficult to explore. And what we've been doing is we've been testing both the standard and the Ajax Spider against this. And as you can see, there's certain things. The standard spider actually finds quite a lot, but the Ajax Spider will find some things that the standard spider doesn't. And you also see now we've got this client column. Now, this is just the nodes, the URLs that the client add-on found that the Ajax Spider didn't. So if the Ajax Spider found it, then the client add-on will have seen it as well. So we're ignoring those. We're just reporting the things that the client add-on will find that were not found by the Ajax Spider. You can see in some cases, they were found by the standard spider, but not by the Ajax one. So if you have a modern web application and you know that the Ajax Spider isn't exploring it as effectively as you think it should be, then try the client add-on and see if that actually improves it for you. Because we know in certain cases it will, and if it doesn't, let us know.
So it's very true, Simon, very true. So just a minute on theory on this, right? So if we look at the definition of an Ajax spider, as you said, basically we're referring to an asynchronous JavaScript and XML technology, right? And that crawling is dependent on the queries of the DOM based on functionality that involves clicky-drabby-droppy around the website. Selenium or any application can only guess the asynchronous functionality if it can't reach it. And that's where the plugin that you just referenced comes in. That interaction is complete by inspection of the document object model or DOM, And that then gives you the extra coverage that you just demonstrated for a variety of different websites, including the Google Maze.
Exactly. So while we're talking about it, I will actually launch Firefox again, because the key thing here is, if you have a look here, we have the extensions, and this is how it all works. We have the ZAP browser extension. Now, you will notice that this can always read and change data on this site. This is a little bit surprising if you've played around with extensions, because it is actually difficult. Well, Firefox doesn't allow extensions to have full access to all websites. Now, so the ZAP browser extension is available on the Firefox and Chrome stores. So what do we call addons.mozilla.org and the Chrome extensions. And we've had to do some reverse engineering on how Firefox actually handles security in order to get this to work. So you may, if you ever notice a dot there, then there may be a problem, and let us know, because it's taken a little bit of while to get this working. But you will see we have this browser extension, and this actually allows us to record events in the browser as well. I'm not going to cover this now, because that's actually a Google Summer of Code project, and hopefully the student will do the video on that themselves. If not, we'll do another video. And we do have various options. So you can install this add-on yourself. But then you would have to set up the so if you don't want to launch Firefox or Chrome from ZAP, then you will need to configure some information. This is another reason why it's much better to launch your browsers through Firefox. Through ZAP, because then we can actually ensure that the relevant extensions are installed and working as correctly. And I'll just go and launch Chrome as well, because I'm feeling lucky and I haven't tried this. Sometimes takes a little while. I think the web driver's just updated. So,
and only this week we had the approval on the Chrome plugin update. Is that correct?
Exactly. So what we do is we have to submit these add-on, the extensions, to both Firefox and Chrome. And Firefox, the approval is pretty quick, but the Chrome one isn't as quick. So we do know that it takes a little while before we actually see, before that gets approved. So, and we can see it's coming up. And what you'll see is, we have the ZAP browser extension here, which looks very similar. So we have the same information, and it's just taking a little bit longer to load here. And of course, all of this stuff is open source. So there is, you can look at the source code for the extension and all of ZAP, of course. And that's probably about it. I mean, one thing to say is future plans. Right now, we're exposing information and getting more information from the DOM to make the Ajax Spider better. But we do have plans to do both passive scanning on the client side and active scanning as well. Obviously, DOM XSS is going to be one of the top ones for there. But if you've got any other suggestions of any other functionality you'd like to be included, then please let us know. There's loads of ways to get in touch with us. Have a look at zaproxy.org. We've got a user group, a developer group. You can get us, find us on Twitter. We should be very easy to find, particularly myself. That's it for the client add-on as it stands at the moment. Obviously, there's a lot more to do. Please let us know in comments in the video below on YouTube, or get in touch any other way, what you think about this, any suggestions you've got, and if you'd like us to cover anything else in the future. Thank you very much.